Good afternoon, Dr. Preeti. Thank you for coming.
Good afternoon, sir.
Okay, so let us start this program with your permission, if you are ready. So good afternoon, one and all. Thank you for joining with all of us this afternoon. My name is Dr. Aniruddha Babar from the Department of Political Science. I'm also a coordinator of Dot Talks webinar series, and under that, we are organizing relevance of Dr. Ambedkar's and significance of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar today and tomorrow. It is a lecture series that we have been running since last couple of weeks. So far, three speakers have spoken on this platform, and now we are blessed to have our fourth speaker. Let me introduce you all with our fourth speaker. She is Dr. Preeti Ojha, and she will be speaking on relevance of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar in today's transient times. Just to have a brief introduction of her, she is an accomplished academician with specialized knowledge in the field of English literature, media studies, communication, and related areas. She is offering demonstrated ability to improve learning across classes. She is proficient in teaching, learning, and pedagogy with more than 15 years of instructional academic experience. Research areas are Dalit and Buddhist studies, media studies, language acquisition, and communication skills, including soft skills. We are really fortunate to have someone all the way from Mumbai to share her knowledge with us on this platform. And again, I repeat, the topic is relevance of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in today's transient time. So without wasting any more moment, I would request Dr. Preeti Ojha to kindly take a charge of this virtual platform and please enlighten us with her thoughts. Ma'am, over to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you and very good evening to all of you. First of all, Dr. Aniruddha, thank you so much for inviting me to such august gathering. Am I audible, sir? Or I need to do something?
Yes, yes, very much, ma'am.
Okay. So would like to thank you, first of all, for just reaching out to me all the way to Mumbai from Nagaland and then giving me an opportunity to be a part of this talk series on such a visionary Saiha of today's time, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Would like to extend my warm regards, first of all, to the founding member, founding father, founding trustees of this institution, and would like to start sharing my screen, sir, with your permission.
Yes, ma'am. Please go ahead.
Just give me some time. I'd like to share my screen. Is my screen there?
Yes, visible and clear.
Okay, thanks a lot. So with this, let me just introduce myself. Sir has already given very lucid introduction. I am Preeti Ojha from Mumbai, St. Andrew's College, working in the UG program of English department and PG program of Mass Media Studies, affiliated to the University of Mumbai. My interest on personal level in Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar has to do with my studies of American literature and especially Black American literature. And during my UG and PG studies, I was actually exposed to the Black American writings like William Faulkner and all. And that has actually given me very intriguing entry into the area of marginalized, first literature, then life, then speakers, then leaders. And then I started working on Dalit studies, Dalit literature first and Dalit writings later on. And then that has given me some guided way to the Dalit Buddhist identities. And when it comes to Dalit Buddhist identity, that was the time my interaction with Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar's thoughts and ideology started. It's been more than 10 years I've been working on his ideologies, on his thoughts, on his papers, on his articles, trying to connect him to literature, life, poetry, music, somewhere. So this is what is my relevance today to be here on this platform. So first of all, would like to acknowledge and thank Dr. P.S. Lorin, Sri Chairman and Principal Emeritus of the Tetsu College, Nagaland, Dr. Hivasa Khin, Principal of the College, and Dr. Anirudh Sir, who was very, cordially, very, diligently connecting with me and then sorting my all the queries on, so many calls and messages. So this is a humble acknowledgement of all your efforts, sir, and that is the reason I'm here today. Starting with
thank you so much.
My presentation, some areas which I would like to touch upon today as a part of my presentation would be, of course, because as I was told that the lecture will be open for the public and not only for the academicians. So that way I just thought of, touching upon some important aspects to understand his relevance in today's time. So life sketch, scholarly contributions, public life, contribution to marginalized, analysis of his major thoughts, not all the thoughts, of course, some of the major thoughts we are going to touch upon. Most importantly, his the focus on the caste system and the areas of issues of untouchability in India. Many just don't try and connect Dr. Ambedkar with women empowerment, but my point here is to connect both of these areas so strongly, because most of his ideas are based on the way he has positioned women in the entire structure of the society. And finally, we cannot not talk about two so prominent milestones of Indian history, of like one side Dr. Ambedkar and the other side Mahatma Gandhi. So this is something which I would like to talk about today. On the screen, you can see his brief, sketch of the life, maybe a little bit about his biographical details. And as you can see here that coming from a small place like Mahu in Indore and reaching to the Columbia University and, of course, the London School of Economics, this is a journey what has actually shaped his global mindset. And that was also one of the problems, because the journey which was made from Mahu in maybe 1890s or maybe 1900, which was, in my personal opinion, was little ahead of his time. And maybe that was one of the reasons why we are still trying to place Dr. Ambedkar in the current context. And one of the best, most relevant, most prominent, and still most controversial, quote of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar is that we must stand on our own feet and fight as best as we can for our rights. So carry on your agitation and organize your forces. Power and prestige will come to you through struggle. Now, this is something which is also putting him on a different vertical than Mahatma Gandhi, right? But why I have selected this particular quote today to begin my lecture is that basically the kind of radical attitude what we see in this quote today is something which is still not subdued. And this is why we are still finding Dr. Ambedkar much more relevant in today's life. Let me start with the political career and the way the construction of ideologies has happened. Very elaborated, milestones here. Just quickly going through this. When we talk about Ambedkar, we also have a lot of literature what he has started, because I think this is something what is making him a sort of a mass leader. And we are talking about a phase and the time when even newspaper was not that much type of popular medium to reach out. Forget about social media. But this is where he was a kind of a single-handedly managing the kind of publications, magazines, books, articles, periodicals, or just simple handouts and flyers. And somehow, these handouts and flyers have also worked as a very, you know, connecting force to wherever he has gone, he has traveled, and he has worked with. So the first such case what we are talking about is the Bahishkrit Hitkarini Sabha. And 1924, his very first, you know, step in the active political career, he started in this. This is the basic, you know, step what he has taken. Along with this Bahishkrit Hitkarini Sabha, when the Bahishkrit Bharat and as a newspaper and Mook Nayak as a weekly magazine. So these three has provided a very, you know, connecting bond to many of the, you know, local leaders of that period, and of course the downtrodden people, what that time we used to call them Harijan, maybe a name given by Mahatma Gandhi to the untouchables. So here are some of the, you know, important aspects. 1932, for the very first time, All India Untouchability League. I mean, no one could have thought of doing this, uniting them together. This is where the power of Masaiha lies. 47, our very first, you know, elected Minister of Law in Nehru cabinet. And he was the one to have the very first, you know, difference about the Hindu code bill. We are going to talk about it in the further slides. After independence also, his own area of, you know, working towards the downtrodden, Dalits, and the untouchables in India, he did not stop. Because I think he was totally disappointed the way we have received the kind of, you know, independence, the way we have received our own India. This was not supposed to be the way he has, you know, envisioned. We are going to talk about that also further. And this gives us something which is very prominent even today to talk about. Before that, I would like to just, you know, ask, sir, my screen visible? Am I audible?
Ma'am, I think your screen is visible, but on which slide you are? Because we are only seeing, you know, I think it's top, I guess. Because we are only seeing Dr. Ambedkar's photograph. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Can you please share your screen once again?
Oh, slides were not moving?
Yeah, slides were not moving. So I was just wondering whether you are moving slides or whether they are keeping it like this.
Yes, I was moving slides.
Oh, and then that not visible at all. Right. Yes. Yes. Now we are able to see your slide number one. Relevance
sir,
of Dr.
Ambedkar. Guess when I go for slideshow, I think, is this changing now?
Can you move your slides?
I am moving my slides.
No, not. I think maybe some network issues from your side.
No, I think this is not taking my slideshow mode. No problem.
Okay. All right.
My apologies for not showing you the slides. I'll be very quickly, you know, sharing my screen and running at least first 2-3 slides which I was talking about. Sorry, good I asked you, sir, in between.
It's okay, ma'am. Doesn't matter. After all, technical issue. Yeah.
No, I'll just continue.
Yeah, please.
Slides there.
Yes, your first slide is visible. Can you click on the second?
Now I need to take individual slides, I guess, because I'm not able to.
Yes, yes, yes. Yes, you have to take individual slides. That would be better, I guess. Yeah.
Yes. Okay, no problem. So this is something which I've already told you. The flow of my presentation would be like this. Introduction, life sketch, scholarly contributions, public life, contribution to marginalized. Analysis of some of the major thoughts, status of caste, Ambedkar and women, and finally the confluence of Ambedkar versus Mahatma Gandhi. And as I was talking about his life sketch. Sir, please let me know if my slides stop moving because I'm not able to see my slides.
Sure, sure. No problem. Now we can see early life.
Yes, okay. So this is something which is like the biographical picture of he coming from a small town in Mahu in MP and going to the Columbia University. As I told you, that this may be one of the reasons why we have to reposition him today, that he was much ahead of his time in whatever he was doing. And then I have told you about this particular quote also. Sir, once last time I'll try putting it on the slideshow. If it doesn't come, then I will have to stop. Is this moving now in the slideshow, sir?
No, ma'am. I think better whatever you are doing now, let us continue with that. I think that would be.
Yes. Okay. So this is the quote I've already spoken about, that this is the crux of his entire, you know, difference and different ideologies, which is making him different from the other contemporary leaders. That we must stand on our own feet and fight as best as we can for our rights. So carry on your agitation and organize your forces. Power and prestige will come to you through struggle. So with this, he has started his political, you know, career, and construction of his ideology also was coinciding with his structure. And here we can, I've already told about 1924, his very first entry into the active politics in the form of, you know, making Bahishkrit Hitakarini Sabha. And I think also told about the way he has also made the periodicals, magazines, writings, posters, flyers, very, very, you know, popular. And that was one of the reasons why he also, as you know, insisted, supported, encouraged, and motivated the kind of education for all. We are going to talk about that also in the coming slides. And then we also spoke about 1947, the very first Minister of Law, elected minister in the Nehru cabinet. But from there, I guess the problem has already started with the elected leaders and the ideologies, the clash in ideologies. We find immediately after the independence, their very first cabinet meeting. But then also, I think the way he has foreseen the kind of changes with the independent India was not something which he got in final bargain. Then the shift in his ideology from the active politics to the actual grassroots level working with the life and lifestyle and the life condition of the untouchables in India, even after 1947, that is after the independence. And that has somehow put him to a very different mode of, different kind of a mood, different kind of a thought process. And he tried searching many of the answers into the religion itself. And that was very, that has actually worked as a catalyst when he has participated in the World Buddhist Conference for the first time in 1949. And then he says that lost rights are never regained by begging and by appeals to the conscience of the usurpers, but by relentless struggle. Goats are used for sacrificial offerings and not lions. I mean, the kind of radicalism, the kind of aggressiveness, the kind of frustration, the kind of anger, it has never ceased. Somehow, whatever kind of quotes what we see today, this is underlined. I mean, that kind of anger, that kind of frustration always underscores whatever he's about to say. Somehow, he was always, instigating, I would like to use that word in a very restricted manner, but he did not see any other way to have that level playing field with the different caste problems or the social problems. And then when he has started writing about all these things, and this is where the entire, the complete crux of his writing. Right from 1923 to 1957, almost till the time his he died, he passed away. And even after that, because many of the books and works and articles are being published even after his death. So this is something which is actually giving us a very strong and big body of his works, which is actually helping us today, people like you and me. We are trying to position his ideas today. We are trying to reposition him today. We are trying to make him, we are trying to make him very relevant today, only because we have this kind of complete, big body of big volumes of work, ideas, thoughts, talks, articles, and ideologies in the written form with us. Then comes his another very, strong issue. Equality may be fiction, but nonetheless, one must accept it as a governing principle. Now, on this basis, this one line has actually made him write the entire constitution, where the equality is always resonating almost on every page of the constitution. Now, when we talk about the Constitution of India, of course, we all know about this part of recent history, that he was made the chairman of the drafting committee, and then the first text or the first draft has already, guaranteed us a lot of, civil liberties for individual citizens, religion, social, upliftment. And in this particular, treatise, in this particular work, I mean, the institution, the Constitution of India, when we say that, he has also argued, and he has also given us a kind of a, what we say, the Holy Bible sort of a thing, the commandment sort of a thing, for all of us today, that each and every word of the institution, institutional practices, wherever we are seeing in India, it is completely giving us a total, absolute, 100% sense of equality and equity, almost on paper. I'm not talking about the execution part of it. On paper, just remove any page, any law, any act, and then you will see the wonder he has tried, the kind of utopia he has seen, the kind of, idealistic society he has projected. So this is where he argued for extensive economic and social rights for women and almost every possible strata of the society. Now, when we talk about the Constitution of India, why we are talking about it today? This is what is the crux of the talk about Dr. Ambedkar today. That the preamble of the Constitution of India, if we make sure that each and every word is converted into reality, then India actually can, be on the complete idealistic state. That the selection of each and every word here is also giving us a lot of things to think about, a lot of ideas to ponder over. That even after so many years, which part of this preamble is completely 100% attended, accepted, or attained? No, I'm sorry. We have not yet reached even half it. And then when he was trying to define the word democracy, he said that, and I quote, "My definition of democracy is a form and method of government whereby revolutionary changes in the economic and social life of the people are brought about without bloodshed." Now, why he's talking about bloodshed? Because basically he was having a lot of westernized ideology, and unlike many of the Indian National Congress leaders, he was not very much comfortable with the kind of ideologies what Gandhiji has propagated, and the people of India have started following. But somewhere down the line, he was also expecting no bloodshed. Somehow this word is not very much fitting into his entire scheme of liberty, equality, and fraternity. Maybe these three words, when we try and connect it to maybe long back, say for example, the the French Revolution. Let's say, for example, when we are finding these three words for the first time being used during the French Revolution, the bloodshed goes hand in hand when we are talking about any democracy. So the way we have attained democracy somewhere, he was also amused. Dr. Ambedkar was amused. And then he was also telling that also he is expecting it, but somehow not very much attainable. And another very prominent thing, what is making him relevant, is that the constitution and the capacity to go for amendments. And clauses of the constitution, flexible, very much, you know, amendable. And this is also to keep it lively, keep it alive, keep it flexible, and to keep it dynamic. And then we say what we think of the fundamental rights. And when we talk about Article 15, 2, or 17, or 23, or 24, and then when we are putting all these four words together, that no discrimination on the ground of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth, somewhere down the line, we also know that what he's talking about, the deep-rooted, grassroots-level problems of the Hindu religion, to put it in a very, very particular state. Now, I'm not generalizing here. And to get rid of the dogmas of Hindu religion, which has actually given rise to so many other issues because of the, you know, straightforward, or maybe because of the debatable forerunners, he tried to give us an answer. He tried to give us some solutions to these problems through this one holy Bible, that is the Constitution of India. Sir, am I audible, visible? Because I'm not able to see the audience.
Yes, yes, you're audible, you are visible, we are listening to you.
Okay, thank you. What he wanted by making the fundamental rights so very significant, he wanted justice, justiciable. And this is something which he was counting on it on the Constitution of India till he died. That he said that, and he believed that the moment these rights are justiciable, I have my complete faith in the Constitution and the people of India. There are some areas which are still, you know, under consideration, whether to seek the completion of this thing or no. But I think the propagating by just by, you know, mentioning these ideas in the Constitution. So, for example, he insisted on Hindu code bill, suggesting the basic improvements and amendments in the assembly. Now, these are some of the ideas where, though he could not come to the consensus, though he could not convince the local, the contemporary government to go ahead and make it a bill to pass in the parliament, but it has given the generations, from generation to generation, enough, you know, enough food for thought. And then many of the social upliftment movements in the last 30, 40 years are completely based upon these ideas, what he has for the first time mentioned in the Constitution of India. Through the Constitution of India, his biggest contribution and maybe the most controversial, why we are talking about him today, are maybe five areas under the social reforms. Now, just let me put it very, you know, clearly here, that when we talk about Dr. Ambedkar and his relevance today, I don't think we are going to limit ourselves into maybe social reform, or he as an economist, or Dr. Ambedkar as a lawyer or a barrister, or Dr. Ambedkar as a maker of the Constitution. Maybe he is wearing so many hats at a time, and these roles are so interconnected that it is difficult for any of us to, you know, talk about Dr. Ambedkar in isolation. I mean, these all are very interconnected areas of his life. Fortunately, that kind of an expertise, that kind of education, that kind of qualification actually gave him complete right and complete power to critique upon the idea, to propagate any idea. And that is what is making him the most, you know, comprehensive kind of a leader to talk about so many areas maybe so many problem areas of the Indian society today. Starting with the first one, that reconstructing Hindu social order and religion. Now, I would like to hear talk about these ideas, but all these ideas are basically already mentioned in his books and articles, and these are the ideas where he has very repeatedly written about. And he was somehow not very convinced the way we have finally understood, or maybe we are practicing these ideas. Till date, all these ideas remain controversial, remain open to multiple interpretation, and unfortunately, we are still seeing so many conflicts, sometimes even violent conflicts in the society, in the neighborhood. But when we are talking about it today, let us talk about the first one. When he wanted to go for the Hindu social order and reshuffle of the Hindu social order, these are the things that he suggested, that there should be only one standard book for Hindu religion. It should be acceptable, recognized by all Hindus. Veda, Purana, Shastra should not be treated as sacred. This is the most problematic statement till date for the Sanatan Hindu followers. And somehow the plurality, the multiplicity, the multidimensional aspect of Hinduism is still not ready to accept this. But for Ambedkar, if this would have been accepted, this would have actually made the lives of Hindus also and Indians in general very, very easy. But somehow it still remains with a lot of questions. One more suggestion, priesthood must cease to be hereditary and be on the exam basis. I mean, today it looks like a laughable idea that why a priest should pass any exam. But just try and understand and try and think of it as a rational idea and not a religious idea. That what kind of changes we can actually make if we follow this one small statement, one small suggestion that the priesthood must cease to be hereditary and be on the exam basis. Let me tell you, my dear participants here, that the religion, Hindu religion, Hindu temples, and the entire lineage which runs for the priesthood has done a lot of harm. And that is also not helping the religion to develop the way it has to be developed. Of course, I take complete responsibility of this statement when I'm making it here, but the learned priests, what I mean to say learned is not learned in the regular official formal education. Every religion has its own school of education to train the priests and train the next generation to understand the nuances of the religion. You take it for example, any of this Christianity, Islam, Jainism, Sikhism, Buddhism. They all have very, very established, institutionalized religion, religious studies. And the priests, those who are going through those studies and then coming and taking over religion as a basic way of learning or leading life, in my opinion, they make much more positive difference to the continuation of the religion. They can connect well to the people. So it is basically doing good to the religion in itself. Somehow this one point is not still understood in the Hindu religion and the Hindu priesthood, which is relying more on the lineage, religion, heredity, and everything. You can think of this as, again, one of the biggest question mark on what we are talking about today. He says again that priest should be the servant of the state and should be paid by the state and subjected to disciplinary action. Can we think of it today? No. Unfortunately, this the statement in itself sounds so very offensive to many of people there. The number of priests should be limited by the law. Brahminism is the poison which has spoiled Hinduism. These all are the areas, these all are the questions. If we read his book, Riddles of Hinduism, we are actually talking about one very prominent book here. And this is something which I just wanted to put it in front of my audience today, that these are the areas he has spoken about. Talking about the Varna, what he said, that along with each varna, there are caste, subcaste, and kids, and then there are many, you know, subdivisions of the caste, which are far from pernicious than the four varnas. Today, when India being a very complex, you know, cultural entity, it's very difficult for all of us today to identify anyone just by the name or surname or the caste or the work. It is complicated today, right? It was impracticable to reduce the thousands of castes into four varnas in accordance with the merits and demerits of each individual. The way we have started, you know, dividing on, you know, deciding that only four varnas are there and each and every one will be fitting into all four varnas. Dr. Ambedkar has actually put a very big question mark that how can we do that? The names of Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra have become associated with certain sentiments of high and low and were now based on birth rather than the work. Biggest problem of Indian society till date that we are not able to remove that caste from the birth. And this is somewhere, it is a collective failure. In my personal opinion, it's a collective failure of all of us, right? So unless this social ideal is destroyed root and branch, there cannot be liberty, equality, love, or social brotherhood. So what he suggested that this four varna system should be discontinued and new things must be accompanied by new names. Now this was a suggestion, a very, very strong suggestion. But what happened after that? Then he says that turn in any direction you like. Caste is the monster that crosses your path. You cannot have political reform. You cannot have economic reform unless you kill this monster. This was told almost 70, 80 years back. How many of us are still finding it relevant? I find it relevant. I find it very, very relevant today because somehow this monster is still haunting us day in and day out, and our generation, current generation, our future generations are all being bugged by this monster every day. Somehow Dr. Ambedkar's lineage, it has not made much difference to all of us. Third point in the social reform. So the system of scaling caste in graded order should be abolished. What he suggested? He suggested intercaste marriages, dignity behind caste, education should be made compulsory and universal, recruitment of army should be open, fair and equal, and there should be right to vote and contest elections, should have equal opportunity to participate in their government. Please remember, these all things were propagated during the making of the Constitution of India. That means 47, 48, 49, these 3 years were like complete, you know, kind of a brainstorming years where these issues were being discussed. Now, why today we are talking about it? You remove any one pointer from the slide and tell me, are we 100% achieving that? No. In fact, unfortunately, maybe since last 2 decades, we are seeing India going back in the maybe it's kind of a very stringent past. Some of the practices which were completely abolished has now started coming back in new forms and new ways and with digital touch. And we are going to talk about it in the later slides. But my point here is to just, you know, put it across that these were the pointers, these were the guidelines, these were the principles propagated. Where are we today? Nowhere. We are still struggling, and that is why he is relevant. Ideal social organization. Equality of opportunity based on social justice for every individual. Now, this is something which I want to talk about, that finally what happened? Equality, the way he has propagated, was never considered in its totality. And that has given rise to another, you know, controversial practice of having reservations. Now, reservation was proposed to give equal kind of, you know, maybe a provide a sort of equity and equality to the underprivileged or lesser, you know, represented classes. But today, after maybe 40, 50 years of this regular practice of reservation in jobs and education and qualification, what we see today is, though at one level, those who have got the benefits of reservations have made a place for themselves, but the social stigma attached to this is not removed. And we all, you know, experience it every day, not only in India now because of the, you know, digital connect and 24/7 wired lifestyle. Day in and day out, we are getting so many examples of maybe caste harassment or maybe the racial harassments for Indians, even abroad. So wherever we go, we carry our own taboos. Wherever we go, we carry our own, you know, hatred. We carry our own, you know, differences. So where, how we say that we have done some justice to Dr. Ambedkar's ideas? Because even today, till date, not a single day newspaper is coming to my home without giving me at least one sad sob story about how a Dalit is tortured here, how a caste discrimination is done there, and how this particular government is talking about that particular caste. We have not yet come to any doable, you know, palpable solution. I'm sorry to say that. Sir, my things visible, audible?
Yes, you are, yes.
Should I continue?
Please, take your time. We are enjoying it. Please go ahead.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So, after talking about these four very, very prominent social reform failures on our part, I deliberately use that word failure because not even on one count, today we can say that, yes, we have made some progress. All four areas, somehow we have failed. And finally, when he's talking about women, I measure the progress of a community by the degree of progress which women have achieved. This is a very, very prominent statement made by him. And he has worked single-handedly during that part to give that kind of a base, that kind of a ground to women in politics, society, education, or jobs. And if you just look at the Constitution, we have some special articles. For example, 17, 15, 1, 16, 4, 46, 164, 331, 1, and 332, 1. All these articles are touching upon the lives of women in various strata of life. So untouchability was constitutionally abolished. It is now a criminal offense. Reservation for scheduled castes provided in legislature and in government services extended to the educational institutions, propounded that women should be given absolute right over property and daughters should have equal share over father's property. Again, I am reminding you that these words were written, propagated, proposed somewhere in 1947, in between 1947 and 1952. Where did we get this? When did we actually get that right, that the father's property is equally shared among daughters and sons? Just 5 years back, if I'm not wrong, it has just happened just 5-6 years back. That means, again on count five, we are still having that sense of failure. So when we're talking about this five areas of social reform, what comes next for us? If you believe in living a respectable life, you believe in self-help, which is the best help. That means, as I told you, that after providing the constitutional benefits, after providing the independent India to have their entire, you know, as an independent world, still Ambedkar's heart was somewhere in the position or maybe the plight of Dalits in those days. And then he never ceased to tell them very honestly to come together. And at the same time, he always asked them to continue with their own kind of movements, fight, aggression, at least protest. So the sense of protest, even today, when we see in so many young you know, educated, qualified, smart young men and women of Dalit communities. Somewhere we can think of this quote: if you believe in living respectable life, you believe in self-help, and which is the best help. Continuing with the kind of support what he has provided, the base what he has provided for women, gender equality, women education, Hindu code bill, women organization, and maternity bill. Today we don't realize the value of these bills because somehow we have taken it for granted. But just imagine a life of a working woman without these all bills. And you can actually think of the type of contribution what we have already received. And constitutional provision, I have already told about this, the numbers, you can check it on the screen, that what these articles are talking about and how these all work in favor of women and children. Of course, we can have a look at this thing here going ahead, touching upon another controversial part, that is religion. I like the religion that teaches liberty, equality, and fraternity. So what happens when the same religion which has made him the outcast, and then when he has told that I don't believe in that religion because that religion has not accepted me, so I will not accept the religion, then what happens? We all know that history, right? He believed, I mean, he tried very hard to make that kind of amend in the religious leader's mind, in social leader's mind, but somehow he could not, you know, succeed to the way he should have. Religion must mainly be a matter of principles only. It cannot be a matter of rules. The moment it degenerates into rules, it ceases to be a religion, as it kills responsibility, which is an essence of the true religious act. Look at the kind of openness in this statement. Look at the kind of, you know, global touch in this statement. Today, when we read this statement, it is equally aptly applicable to any and every religion, any and every religious practice in any part of the world. But somehow, India could not respect the kind of, you know, suggestions made by Dr. Ambedkar in the area of religious practices. He himself was never an atheist. It was not that he did not believe in religion. He was not an atheist. But he was also not very much, very staunch, you know, practitioner of the religion, which practicing, you know, the regular rituals and all. But almost for 30 years of his life, his attitude to religion was neutral, maybe a little social, and he was looking at it from the utilitarian point. And within Hinduism, he had to suffer immensely as an untouchable Mahar. As we have seen that he was born in the Mahar community. Mahar still, a Maharashtrian community, which are still considered as a part of the SC, that is scheduled caste. And he somehow could not understand this basic difference or basic, you know, discrimination just by being born in XYZ place or XYZ parent. 27, very first time, in 1927, of course, that was a time when he was also heavily under the influence of Mahatma Gandhi, and he tried to launch a satyagraha to touch water at the Chowder tank in Mahad, and then the next was to enter the Kalaram temple in 1930. Now, this is the kind of a step which was not accepted well by the established upper class leaders, because somehow this particular instance, or maybe these two events, they looked at it as a kind of a threat to the established Hindu religion, because to get the water from the well, village well, and to enter into the temple where entries are restricted only on the basis of the caste. And then when he tried manually doing it, he was not taken well by almost every possible leader. And then in 1935. So after 5 years of maybe, you know, very harsh opposition, a complete, you know, complete failed attempts to make the leaders make them understand, to make some amends in the established religion, religious scriptures, religious books, he had given up finally in 1935. And then he declared that I was born a Hindu. I had no choice in my birth, but I will not die as a Hindu because I do have a choice. And what was his choice? We all know that he accepted Buddhism. Now, when we look at this entire conversion process today, in today's light, we find it so very relevant that today the Dalits, the marginalized communities in India, no one is getting that kind of a benefit of, you know, being in Hindu religion, because somewhere by giving them different names, right from Harijan to Dalit to scheduled caste to any other name, but it is a name, right? The moment you name it, this is we versus they, and then this we versus they has never ceased, never stopped. So what happened in 1936? He convened a conference of Dalit near Nashik to discuss the issue of conversion. Almost 10,000 attended the Nashik conference, and after discussing the pros and cons, he has opted to go for the conversion Buddhism. Now, why Buddhism? Again, we have a very, very strong, you know, systematic article written by Dr. Ambedkar, where he has put, I mean, of course, that this is what I'm telling you here, that we are talking about a man who was equally, you know, qualified to talk about the canonical Hindu religious scriptures and the other world religion, because he was also one of the best anthropologists. He was also one of the biggest reader for almost every possible Indian Vedic scripture. After doing that, when he has tried to leave that religion, that was also one phase, and very beautiful article is there on that. Vasant Moon has just recently compiled that article under the Government of Maharashtra project, where he had he was contemplating to live without any religion, but to be atheist or maybe to be an agnostic in those days was not a very prominent and popular choice for his followers. So what he proposed Buddhism. There are two reasons why he proposed Buddhism: that there would be no caste, no claims of infallibility, and the main objective was to emancipate the suffering humanity, because the basis of the Buddhism is to go from suffering to the Nirvana, right? So Ambedkar advocated Buddhism not only for India, but also for the entire strife-ridden world. Today, when we look at it, again, the problem comes. Again, the issue comes that what happened? I mean, after he passed away, very shortly after converting to Buddhism, the way the neo-Buddhist, the Dalits, those who converted into Buddhism, and today they are called the neo-Buddhists. Of course, they were following Mahayana, Navayana, and it's a kind of a mixed, you know, cult. But the name was given neo-Buddhist. Who are they today? Those who are worshipping Dr. Ambedkar and Buddha both as their gods. So somewhere, from being a leader to being a god, his journey has not given him that kind of a support, because again, by telling his disciples as neo-Buddhist, we are not still making him a part of the mainstream canonical Hindu religion. So again, what I'm talking about today is we have somewhere failed Dr. Ambedkar miserably, even in that point. Sir, am I audible, visible?
Yes, you are.
How much more time do I have? Because I still have two more important points.
Sure, please go ahead. Take your time.
So the fundamental principle of Buddhism is equality. This is something which is, you know, very strong point for Ambedkar to go ahead with Buddhism. Buddhism was called the religion of Shudras. There was only one man who raised his voice against separatism and untouchability, and that was Lord Buddha. Now, again, this is a little problematic statement and problematic quote here, because if you try and understand this in a kind of a little complicated narrative today, Buddhists are still considered Hindus, number one. Reservations are possible, that means scheduled caste, whoever is put into the list of scheduled caste, they are all considered Hindus. That means somewhere down the line, the entire idea of living or renunciating that religion has not, somehow being successful in India. Because the constitution which was prepared to give them equality is only the constitution which is trying to put them into the overall, crux of the Hinduism. They wanted to leave that word Hindu, and that is why they had opted for Neo-Buddhist. But the religion, the reservation benefits is only given to the scheduled castes, and scheduled castes are only coming from Hindu communities. Others can come into SCs, but SCs are only from the Hindu. So somewhere the entire narrative also has failed, in my personal opinion, that they never wanted to be a Hindu, but just to get the benefit which is proposed by Dr. Ambedkar, they are still called Hindu. Somewhere the narrative is not matching. This is my personal opinion. And then after that, Neo-Buddhist, what we call them today, is a new meaning given to the Buddhism. The essential human condition is not individual suffering because of deeds, but social suffering that is produced by a society based on inequality. So the concept of enlightenment is not about the individual enlightenment. Buddha is not considered here as an individual who is enlightened and reached to the state of nirvana. This is a society. This is projected. This is a vision for a society which is founded on liberty, equality, fraternity, justice, and compassion. And then emancipation through religion. Conversion to Buddhism was done only on the basis of humanity. He did not convert as an individual. He did it with his almost 30,000 disciples. It was always a collective act. See, as I told you, that he himself was contemplating not to follow any religion, but he had a larger cause, bigger cause at hand, and that was to uplift the Dalits, to uplift the downtrodden. And he could very well understand that without any religion, this kind of connection of the community will never happen, and that was his own personal reason to go for the collective acceptance or the conversion of Buddhism. He converted to Buddhism not to worship different gods or any god, but as a religion that universalizes the values of human life and to embrace an idea of humanity beyond the social order. So it was not that the Buddha, the institutionalized Buddhist, religion has appealed to him. No, even today, when we consider and compare and contrast these two Buddhism, I mean, of course, I'm making this very, very difficult statement here, that the monastic Buddhism is very different today than the socially engaged form of Buddhism. And today, when we talk about the socially engaged form of Buddhism, this is where Dr. Ambedkar's contribution to propagate that Buddhism as a kind of a socially uplifting vehicle has come into picture. So this side of religion was never understood by any other religious leaders or political leaders before Dr. Ambedkar has used it. And then we have a very quick look at how economy also has got benefited through Ambedkar's entire idea. But as I told you, that he was a kind of a person who was not, who we cannot discuss in isolation. So I cannot talk about his position today or his status today or his relevance today without talking about his anthropology, education, religion, or maybe economy. So here we are talking about his connection to economics. Of course, he was the economist by qualification, right? And the entire establishment of the Indian banking system right from the establishment of the Reserve Bank of India, is his brainchild. So we have to give that kind of a, you know, complete, you know, credit to him as an economist. But the kind of ideas what he has propagated for the Indian economy also somehow today is equally relevant. If the depressed classes gained their self-respect and freedom, they would contribute not only to their progress and prosperity, but also by their industry, intellect, and courage would contribute also to the strength and the prosperity of the nation. This is a very, very strong statement, because just by saying this, he's telling the policymakers very openly that by denying the rights to equality to one particular class of the society, you are denying them entry into the mainstream economy, and you are not doing good to your own national economy just by doing that. Very strong statement. And of course, his two ideas very, very prominent even today. First is the intellectual slavery, and the second one is called the shadowing effect. What we mean by the intellectual slavery? He says that Indians most often quote foreign authors, neglecting contributions of own Indians, and shadowing effect of his own magnificent works, which are completely, you know, sidelined or conveniently forgotten, and just to put him as the messiah of Dalits. This is something which we have to consciously remove when we talk about Dr. Ambedkar, because he was not only a Dalit leader, he was not only a Buddhist leader, he was an economist par excellence, he was an anthropologist par excellence, he was a writer par excellence. Somehow, very conveniently, these areas are conveniently forgotten. So, Indian economist, of course, as I have told you already, that a student and professor, Columbia University, and of course, as a professional economist, being a part of the first, you know, the establishment of all the financial institutions. From where did he get his ideas? Because he actually worked very diligently on the historical review of the British economy, the way East India Company has functioned in India. And today, happily sharing that these three ideas, what we are seeing today, are totally based on his own, you know, concept, his own ideas on the Indian economy. Of course, the replacement of Planning Commission by Niti Aayog, provision of Finance Commission, and the entire Constitution of India. Here we can actually see that his ideas are being somewhere, you know, being established into the kind of institutions. Two important things we can quickly discuss, and then we can go ahead with for the final concluding remarks. He said that the economic part of Indian, you know, the Indian economy somehow is not very labor friendly. Now, this is something which he is talking about very extensively in his book, Annihilation of Caste. How and what he's talking, I'm coming to the slide a little later on. So, what he says that the division of labor, a very, very basic economic term, but we use it today. And as per the Varna system, as per this pyramid also is telling us, that untouchables are making the base of that pyramid. But again, what is happening is, in when you go up, the pyramid is becoming narrower, and the Brahmins are not absolutely contributing in the area of labor. And this is a very true picture even after, say, 50 or 60 years of Indian, you know, economic status. So what he said, that Chaturvarna was a concept of division of labor, and annihilation of caste is a division of laborers. And here he also had some confluence with the concept of economics propagated by Mahatma Gandhi. What he said, that the caste system is a major obstacle to economic growth and development through immobility of capital and labor. Untouchability was not only a religious system, it is also an economic system. So we are not, when we talk about untouchability as a social taboo, it is not only touching upon the social fabric, it is equally affecting economic fabric of the society with far worse, you know, severity. And finally, to talk about two important, you know, global leaders, what we had. Now, I have selected two quotes said by Gandhi on Ambedkar and Ambedkar on Gandhi. When Dr. Ambedkar says, he, that is Gandhi, has almost in everything the simplicity of the child, with the child's capacity for self-deception. Like a child, he can believe in anything. He wants to believe. He may be trying to spiritualize politics. Politics have certainly commercialized him. Very, very strong quote here. On the other side, Gandhi's quote, "You have burned as an untouchable, but I have adapted myself as an untouchable." I mean, this is somehow Gandhiji's own way of, you know.
Ma'am, may I disturb? Your slide is not moving.
My slide is not moving?
About the quote, yeah.
Was this my slide last time? Is my slide there, sir?
Yeah. This was your last slide, yes.
Okay.
Thank Dr. Ambedkar's quote, yes.
Yes. So when we see, I think this is a very important part of, I see this quote as Gandhi's own, you know, maybe a kind of sort of a damage control, where he could not help to remove the problem of untouchability, even after having such a widespread, you know, connect and power and influence over Indian people. Somewhere down the line, he could not make any change. And that is why I think this is a very kind of a personal response he is giving to Ambedkar, saying that you are born as an untouchable, but I have adapted myself as an untouchable. But not very, in my personal opinion, not very convincing though. Now, when we talk about both the ideas, both of them, when division of labor versus division of laborer, village and the salvation of India, Gandhi has given a call to people to back to village, to go back to village and revival of village industries. We know, we all know about his concept of Sarvodaya, right? And the Gram Swaraj. But Ambedkar was more into agriculture as the most congested occupations. That was the time he has actually had that vision that agriculture will not answer the problems of Indian economy. And luckily, after almost 40-50 years, in 1990s and 1995, we tried, we understood the problem, and we have opened up for the global economy. So thankfully, some areas, some ideas, we see the results today. That when he said that agriculture is the most congested occupation, hence salvation of the whole India lies in the greater urbanization. This was Ambedkar's view. And then when we think of him today, we cannot just overlook the way he had made that impact, that unless you go for the greater urbanization, greater industrialization, Gram Swaraj and Sarvodaya will not answer the future, you know, challenges of the economy of India. And we all are seeing the results today. Indian agriculture is an occupation, not an industry. And the counter argument given by Dr. Ambedkar is that greater urbanization, reviving our towns, driving excess population to towns, industrialization is a sound remedy for problem of small holding. We could see this kind of argument happening almost 50, 60 years back. And today, when we have actually taken a stand as a country, and we are seeing some good results, I think we can actually finally thank Dr. Ambedkar today. And now, coming back to, again, two very important, you know, differences in both the ideologies, Ambedkar versus Gandhi. We mean no harm to the Hindu society when we demand separate electorates. If we choose separate electorates, we do so in order to avoid the total dependence on the sweet will of the caste Hindu in a matter of affecting our destiny. This is a quote written with reference to the Pune Pact. Unfortunately, when Dr. Ambedkar has demanded a special, specific, separate electorate for the Dalits, for the untouchables, and Gandhiji had to go for the fasting until death, and then when finally, just to save the life of Gandhi, leaders had actually come together and convinced Dr. Ambedkar to withdraw his demand, that was the time when we had something like Una Pact. But in the view of the mass upsurge, when and of course to save the life of Gandhi, he was compelled to soften his stand. So the separate electorate, don't know. Today, I don't want to comment on it in isolation of all these situations put together. But just imagine the kind of a strong, you know, demand he has put forward. So when the reservation was allowed, why the separate electorate was such a big problem? I mean, today, again, a question to ponder over. So last few slides. Why do we need Ambedkar's thoughts and ideology today? Because he was all of this put together. So today we cannot talk about legality, discrimination, inequality, governance, caste, history, politics, or economics of India in last 50 years without talking about Dr. Ambedkar's contribution in that. He was determined to address social reality as it is and not just how we would like it to be. And this is a very, very strong, you know, connection here, and very, very idealistic, at the same time realistic take, that address the issues as it is. Do not isolate it in some utopian world and then try and talk about it. He took the perspective of those at the bottom who are oppressed. He insisted that the conditions of the poor were the result not of individual disappointments, but of the working of the social system under which they lived. That means there is no one single person responsible for the evils of the society. Society collectively is responsible for all the evils which is happening. Equity, which is the deeper and more embracing problem with which Dr. Ambedkar grappled, and equity and equality, both the things he somehow could not put it together, and he was trying to get it, always a struggle to get both the things. And we still believe in his ideas because dispossessed would progress on the basis of claims to right that they were theirs by the means of organizations that they and nobody else controlled. Dalits hold civil rights, universal human rights, and will not depend upon the gift, leadership, or patronage of others. Worldwide, the oppressed and the exploited people desire not charity, but the realization of their rights, whether right to health, right to education, right to equal treatment, or right to justice. And he was a founding figure of such confident claims. And that is why we are still talking about Ambedkar's journey today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Preeti, for this really enlightening and very engaging lecture. I mean, it was like an intellectual treat, you know, for all of us. Because when you look at Ambedkar, you basically look at, as you rightly mentioned, that he was wearing different hats, okay? And he was a lawyer, he was an academician, he was a policymaker, he was a politician, he even shared his thoughts on water management, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, even on the water management. So, you know, when we engage ourselves with Ambedkar, we realize that Ambedkar was never a Dalit leader. He was never a Dalit leader, right? He was basically a visionary who had inclusiveness in his approach.
Absolutely, a global leader. I would always call him a global leader.
Indeed, a global leader. I mean, even if you look at Dr. Ambedkar's contribution to the tribal upliftment, especially for the people of the Northeast also, that is also very prominent. When it comes to the issues of the women, when it comes to even the issues of the minorities, right? The religious minorities, Dr. Ambedkar's name is proudly taken. So, madam, first of all, thank you so much, you know, for bringing all these things together on this, our platform. And we are really blessed to have it. But now, before the question comes, I'm opening this platform now for the questions, right? Questions will be coming. But let me ask you the first question, right? we have nicely discussed about the relevance of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, okay, to all of us as human beings, okay, I should say that as an Indians as well as human being. But still somewhere we feel that the way the Ambedkar needs to be projected in Indian society has not been done so far. Like in many communities, Ambedkar's contribution is ignored because Ambedkar has never been able to reach to those people, the thoughts of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, right? So what could be the reasons behind that? Okay, is it happened deliberately because some sort of grudges against Dr. B.R. Ambedkar? Or what exactly happened? Because Gandhi is everywhere, right? Mr. Gandhi's thoughts, his ideology, his satyagraha is everywhere. His loving and kindness is everywhere. But Ambedkar's notion of justice and equality and to make a man as a human being, right, is nowhere to be found. So what is your take on it, Dr. Preeti? Please go ahead.
Very interesting question. And I think my answer will intrigue you further rather than, you know, answering it. But I think I would like to quote Foucault here, the concept of power and knowledge. And when the making of knowledge or making of the system is in the hands of powerful, and if the powerful is not, you know, convinced about somebody's knowledge, then that person will not come as a part of the mainstream canonical life ever. Reason for Dr. Ambedkar's, you know, consistent, very deliberate, systematic denial into the public foray, maybe two reasons. First is somehow after he embraced Buddhism and then just within 4 months, 3 months, he passed away. So the last few months, he was always, I mean, he has actually given a very big jerk to the mainstream Hindus. Just by, I mean, who just leaves the Hinduism and goes out and embraces the new religion? So the mainstream Hindus were still not able to come out of that shock, I guess. And then finally, the way the neo-Buddhist has started continuing, and instead of putting his very, you know, kind of ideas, systematic ideas, he was projected more as a god. So instead of being a thinker, he was a god. Today also in any, you know, neo-Buddhist community's house you go, you will find two pictures, Buddha and Ambedkar put together. So the moment you worship someone, I don't think that person is any further taken, because then he has reached to that epitome of worship, and then there is nothing matters much. This is one, probably the reason of he not being in the list of Indian global leaders even today.
Yes, very true. I mean, I really do agree with, you know, your explanation. And there are some also, you know, the political dynamics that we cannot ignore.
Always. Okay?
Yeah, they are there. I really want to quote here something which I was just recalling while you were giving your presentation. Dr. Ambedkar was appointed as a professor of Government Law College, Churchgate, Bombay. And I'm also a product of the Government Law College.
Oh.
And yeah, and when I used to see the name of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, you know, as a principal of Government Law College, he had a tenure of 2.5 years, right? He was there. And, you know, the strange kind of energy that we derive from it, right? Because once upon a time, Dr. Ambedkar used to sit here and he was the one who was administering the entire administration of the college, right? So that is one thing, but this is not a point that I'm making. I'm making a point here about my friend. Okay, he was from the Northeast, and we used to have debate and discussions all the time, okay, about social issues as a student, 20, 21, 22-year-old students. So he was given an opportunity, and he delivered such a wonderful lecture on what he feel about Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, right? And I really want to quote here. He said that, dear friends, our ancestors used to live in jungles. When we were living in the jungles, no one from our neighbors comes to see us that how the Nagas, how the Northeast people are living there. But the missionaries came all the way from the America to see how we are living. Upper class Hindus or upper class people never bothered to even to see how we are living, right? And this reality, when we understand in the context of the Ambedkarite discourse, this reality gets more visible. And then somewhere I realized that how Dr. Ambedkar's discourse is very closer, to the suffering that the entire Northeast, our tribal friends from the Northeast region have completely undergone. Even Dr. Ambedkar somewhere also quote that Northeast region is a special region. Why is it a special region? Because it is less Hinduized region. Because people there are more liberal. People more there, they are not yet contaminated. He was comparing between tribals from the mainland India and the tribals from the Northeast, right? And that was the reason he was proposing a special system to protect their sovereignty, the tribal sovereignty, the traditional sovereignty of the tribal communities as well, you know. So this is just a wonderful picture that we actually get to see where everybody has something to take from Dr. Ambedkar. But I want to ask you something a little bit different, right? Ambedkar had a good study on the international relations also, right? And many a times he tried to warn Pandit Nehruji about the intentions of the China, right? And now Ambedkar again in international relations also, Ambedkar is very relevant now, okay? So would you like to comment anything on it? Ambedkar's views on the international relations and how he perceived international relations and how come he became so correct about China's intention at that point of time?
I remember the very first, you know, conflict what he had in the Nehru's parliament, Nehru's cabinet, about, the entire idea of inviting machineries from abroad. And that was the time when all these Navaratna, what we call today, they were in process. And then when Nehru and the cabinets, and they were all in favor of making it in India, Ambedkar was always in favor of getting the machinery. And that was the time when he was the one to maybe recommend the German machineries to get it in India for the first time, and which was vehemently, protested and objected against. So maybe he was, as I told you in the beginning of my talk, that he was much ahead of his time. And this was also one of the reasons why we are still not able to connect Ambedkar in the time which he lived, actually. So this is one of the reasons.
Yes. Very, very, very true. Dear friends, do you have any question to ask to ma'am? Maybe a curiosity you want to share. You're always welcome. Please go ahead.
Yes. Interaction is always good.
Okay, it seems one question has come from our friend, Professor Dr. Avive D. She is our regular participant. Thank you, ma'am, for your question. I'll read it out for you, Dr. Priti.
I am reading it in the chat box, I guess.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm
yeah,
reading it.
Please check it out.
Right,
yeah.
Ma'am has stated that Dr. P.R. Ambedkar left Hinduism for Buddhism, which is considered to be a religion of equality. However, some of the scholars would opine that even the other religion like Buddhism, Islam and Christianity is embedded with casteism, which is not free from inequalities in a country like India. Would like to have your comment?
Madam, very good question. Yes.
Very good question. Unfortunately, I absolutely agree to this, that when we talk about Buddhism, I would like to give, I think I've told about this thing in my talk, that the converted neo-Buddhist Dalit, converted Dalit who accepted Buddhism, who adopted Buddhism, I mean, some of them have adopted Christianity, some of them have gone to Buddhism. Even there, the hierarchy is still there. I'm putting a very real life picture of Mumbai. I live in Mumbai, and I give you my own experience. You must have heard about Dr. Narendra Jadhav, our own member of parliament and university vice chancellor of Pune, and very renowned, politician, Rajya Sabha member right now. His brother, Dr. A.D. Jadhav, was the municipal commissioner of BMC. Some years back, and then he is also very vocal about Dalits and the social reforms. And I had one chance to interact with Dr. Jadhav that time. He said, "Preeti, I live in Juhu, being a commissioner and as a retired commissioner, I have my nice flat and nice place in Johor. But more than two or three occasions, some domestic help and domestic workers have refused to come to my work for the domestic work. Why? Because I have Dr. Ambedkar's photo and Buddha's statue in my house. And incidentally, these housekeeping maids are coming from the so-called upper class, and they would not work in my, you know, flat, even if I'm ready to give them more money. And Juhu is one of the poshest area in Mumbai, and money and filthy rich people are staying there. That means what I am trying to tell you, ma'am, is that what you have observed is absolutely right. By just getting converted into some religion, the sense of equality is never achieved. A very grim, very melancholic picture of the society. But I do agree that this is not the permanent solution. No.
Here I want to share my few pens. See, the thing is that somewhere my observation tells me that the Ambedkar's vision, specifically if I want to speak about Buddhism, I'll speak about Christianity and Islam also, that Ambedkar's view of Buddhism, right, have not been properly grasped and understood by his own people. That is point number one, right? Now, when it comes to Islam and Christianity, you have to refer to annihilation of caste, if I'm not mistaken. Am I correct, Dr. Preeti?
Would you like to still ask, or I can interrupt?
Well, I'll just complete and then I'll come back to you. So there in the annihilation of caste, Dr. Ambedkar has clearly observed that, you know, we are subjected to the imitation, the evil imitation, right? So the system of the caste, okay, is also imitated by, which is very very much part of you know, the Hindu tradition, is imitated by the Christians also, by the Muslims also. You go to Jains, you know, they also have, and Buddhism is altogether a different issue, right? But also they also have that. But if you look at their seminal text, you know, the seminal text, Jesus Christ was talking about social freedom, right? Jesus Christ was talking about social freedom, freeing people from the social misery and discrimination. So from where this caste came in the theology of Christianity, that is point number one. So Dr. Ambedkar answers that in annihilation of caste, right? Same with the Islam. You go and read the Quranic text, there is no mention of any kind of stratification, any kind of caste that we understand, the untouchables and non-untouchables, right? There is no mention of that. That higher Muslims and lower Muslims is something, you know, which came, you know, much later on, right? So these are the things that we have to really understand, especially in the context of how caste got percolated in those religions, which basically never have any seminal theological substance for the nourishment of the caste system. Madam, over to you. What do you have to say?
Yes, sir. What I would like to say is, see what happened. 36, after almost 3 years of direct, indirect conflict and contemplations and discussions with his own people and all, and reading about the world literature, maybe these 3 years, he has completely, you know, explored entire treaties and, you know, discussions on the world literature, because he basically wanted to accept, adopt one religion. And unfortunately, when he decided to go for the Buddhism, and in just 3 to 4 months, he passed away. So his death, very untimely death, has left such a big void for his followers, because many of them, sir, if you remember, they were just blindly following and going to Nagpur and then, you know, following his own without having much discussion.
Very true.
So he could not get any time to explain and, you know, substantiate or convince his own people about his decision. Then what happened in his absence? Buddhism was done. I mean, conversion was done. But everyone has started having their own interpretation. So what happens? Once you make Dr. Ambedkar as the god, and then you start blindly following whatever was told to you, there was no further chance and scope to explore the rationale behind this entire thing. And this is one of the most unfortunate event of history, in my opinion, that at least 2 more years, if he would have got after the conversion of Buddhism, the scene would have been really different.
Yes, quite possible. It is always said that if you want to destroy somebody, make him or her a god. You know,
god, yeah, exactly.
we have n number of gods and goddesses around us. Yeah. But anyway, any other question or comment, you know, from the participants?
Sir, you can share my email ID with them, and then I will always, you know, welcome their queries, questions.
Yeah, sure. And I have some articles on
Ambedkar, sir. You can share my articles with the audience.
Sure. And I'm going to invite you once again, and please do visit us in Nagaland. Okay.
Absolutely. You guys are lucky to be in that exotic place. Be safe and stay safe. Yeah.
Oh yes. Okay, Preetiji. Now I think we should conclude this program.
Yes.
Thank you so much, first of all, for connecting with us all the way from Bombay. Okay. And yes, Dr. Ambedkar is a very complicated personality. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And it is very difficult to understand Dr. Ambedkar, not only as a person, but also as different identities, you know, that he carries. It is a very difficult thing. Right. But you tried your level best to decipher Dr. Ambedkar for all of us, and we are really grateful for you,
thank you, sir,
for that. And also the participants, thank you for coming, and thank you for having a patient, you know,
yes,
hearing to this lecture. This is the success of what we are doing now. We are learning, we are unlearning,
yeah, we are learning,
and again,
right,
we are learning. With these words, I conclude this. Thank you, Preetiji.
Thank you.
Thank you,
thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Have a good day and have a great evening ahead. We will meet again.